whoever that was. Could have been me. Good morning and welcome. We're so glad that you're here today. Special welcome to any guests we have. We're glad you're here worshiping with us. Thank you for registering for our services, for social distancing in the pews, for having your mask on when you're speaking and singing and all of that. And so let's stand and begin our worship together as we sing, Lift Up Your Heads. And the Holy Spirit.
And blessed be his kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear what our Lord Jesus Christ says. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Lord, have mercy upon us.
Christ, have mercy upon us.
Lord, have mercy upon us.
Thank you.
Standing, let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, you govern all things both in heaven and on earth. Mercifully hear the supplications of your people, and in our time, grant us your peace through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Please be seated.
A reading from Paul's first letter to the Thessalonians. For you yourselves know, brothers, that our coming to you was not in vain. But though we had already suffered and been shamefully treated at Philippi, as you know, we had boldness in our God to declare to you the gospel of God in the midst of much conflict. For our appeal does not spring from error or impurity, or any attempt to deceive. But just as we have been approved by God to be entrusted with the gospel, so we speak, not to please men, but to please God who tests our hearts. For we never came with words of flattery, as you know, nor with a pretext for greed. God is witness. Nor did we seek glory from people, whether from you or from others, though we could have made demands as apostles of Christ. But we were gentle among you, like a nursing mother taking care of her own children. So being affectionately desirous of you, we were ready to share with you not only the gospel of God, but also our own selves, because you had become very dear to us. The word of the Lord. The portion of the Psalter for today is from Psalm 1. Let's read it responsively by half verses. Blessed is a man who has not walked in the counsel of the ungodly,
nor stood in the way of sinners, and has not sat in the seat of the scornful.
But his delight is in the law of the Lord. He shall be like a tree planted by the waterside, his leaf also shall not wither. For the ungodly, it is not so with them. Therefore, the ungodly shall not be able to stand in the judgment. For the Lord knows the way of the righteous,
thank you.
The Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Matthew. Glory to you, Lord Christ. The 22nd chapter, beginning at the 34th verse. But when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together. And one of them, a lawyer, asked him a question to test him. Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law? And he said to him, You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, and with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the great and first commandment. And a second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets. Now, while the Pharisees were gathered together, Jesus asked them a question, saying, What do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he? They said to him, The son of David. He said to them, How is it then that David, in the Spirit, calls him Lord, saying, The Lord said to my Lord, Sit at my right hand until I put your enemies under your feet. If then David calls him Lord, how is he his son? And no one was able to answer him a word, nor from that day did anyone dare to ask him any more questions. The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Now may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all our hearts be always acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Please be seated. Well, a warm welcome to you all. Good morning. This 21st Sunday in Pentecost. And I'm excited about this today because I get to address in this sermon, not exhaustively, but at least directly, one of the great and enduring, we should say, debates within the Christian tradition, one of the great misunderstandings. And it is something that has vexed the Christian church from the very beginning, and that has been the question of love. That's the question. The people have argued about what is love, you know, Hadaway, baby, don't hurt me, you know, what people have argued, you know, I want to know what love is, foreigner, we can keep going, you know, I want to, what the world needs now is love, sweet love, all you need is love. Love is a big deal. People talk about it a lot, both in the church and out, but in the church, we have had a persistent refrain that we, in fact, know what love is. And we have a very unique and specific and clearly delineated definition of what this love is, which then has ramifications for how the church talks to the world about what love, sweet love is. So we're going to talk about that today. So I hope you're excited. I mean, at least a little bit, maybe. Okay. You don't have to raise your hand. So, but before we do that, we're going to look back a little bit at this year. You know, this has become sort of commonplace for people now to say the new normal, you know, these unprecedented times, you know, all these things sort of come out of our mouths. But what else are we supposed to say? You know, like this has been quite a year and these are unprecedented times. And for many of us, this has proven to be a large test. You know, like we say in our pre-marriage counseling, that the pressures of life will begin to expose the cracks in your foundation. You know, well, some people have been realizing that the cracks in their foundation are rather large. You know, some people have been very grateful that they're not very large at all, that the pressures have been very sort of handled. But wherever you end on this, within that spectrum, the reality of it is that because of all these trips that have been canceled and school's been reimagined and work is being rethought of and life is being reordered, that people have been given to reflect in a deeper way about who they are and what actually is going on in their lives. I mean, whether it's been on account of political or sociological or medical reasons or some combination of the three, people's lives have been reoriented and their understanding of themselves and of God have come into question. Well, like you, I have a lot of thoughts about this. Liza knows all about that. I have a lot of thoughts about all these issues. But my main concern as a preacher and a pastor is what the church is doing, what the body of Christ, what the believers, the fellowship of the believers, how are we reacting to all these things? And in many ways, I've been very encouraged. I say with great affection that, you know, the Lord in his providence put me and my family in this church for this year, and I'm so grateful for that, to be with you all, to be with Ted and Joyce and the rest of the staff, and to walk through, yes, these uncertain times with you all. It's been a great joy, and I'm incredibly thankful for the Lord and his mercies. And at the same time, I look outside of of you know, my immediate context, and I can get quite discouraged. I can get quite discouraged by seeing how the sort of the world of professing Christians, as it were, has reacted in particular to the challenges of this year. And while I get discouraged, I have to admit that I'm not really that surprised. Because sort of for those in the know, like the practitioners, you know, the shepherds, we get together and talk, we've been watching this breakdown for a while. I've been feeling that something isn't quite right, and unease. And well, at least with the reaction by many to the challenges of this year, that unease seems well justified. The way back in January, remember, before masks, before in January, remember that was a long time ago. There was a research article that came out from George Barna and the Barna Group, and it was done under the auspices of the Christian Research Center of Arizona. And it was a survey of 2,000 adults in the United States from four major religious groups, the evangelicals, Pentecostals, and charismatics, mainline Protestants, and Catholics. And I remember speaking about this back in my weekend review class way back in January. Some of the findings were a little bit disturbing. And I'll give you some of it from someone sent me an article about this recently, which started my interest back in it. But listen to this article. In this survey, respondents were asked about their views on 51 topics, including marriage, absolute truth, the sanctity of human life, and the authority of the Bible. While there were notable differences among the four Christian traditions, the most startling realization, said researcher George Barna, was, quote, how many people from evangelical churches are adopting unbiblical beliefs? According to his research, 52% of evangelicals now say that they do not believe in objective moral truth or that the Bible is inerrant and trustworthy in all of its content. 75% believe that people are basically good instead of basically sinful. 43% believe Jesus sinned during his time on earth. 58% believe that the Holy Spirit is merely a symbol rather than a person. And a majority of the respondents do not believe in the exclusivity of the Christian faith. Now, that may be shocking to some of you, or maybe it's not shocking to some of you, but particularly if you've been involved in these conversations, like I have, you've been watching sort of the wind blowing as it will, then it's unsurprising. Way back in 2005, 15 years ago, a sociologist named Christian Smith co-authored a book entitled this, Soul Searching, The Religious and Spiritual Lives of American Teenagers. Really quite an interesting book, right? 2005. Well, in it, what he found was that most professing Christian American teenagers profess what he called moralistic therapeutic deism. And what did he mean by that? He said that people essentially thought that to be in church or to be sort of a Christian was to be a good person, moralistic, was to have the church sort of be a therapy session, you know, deal with your anxieties, cares, and concerns, and that ultimately the question of a particular God was less important than just a God in general, i.e. deism, moralistic, therapeutic deism. Well, that was 15 years ago, where ostensibly many of those, if not all, are now what we would consider to be, or at least used to consider to be, adults. Well, as one commentator noted back in 2005, she said this, we're doing a good job of teaching our young people what we actually believe about Christianity, that it's not that big a deal, God requires little, and church is a helpful social institution filled with nice people. Well, that's quite a judgment. And 15 years hence, we should be unsurprised by the results of that Barna survey. And yet, don't worry, we haven't given up. We haven't stopped preaching. We haven't stopped proclaiming what God has in fact given us to proclaim. Because I hope, as certainly your neighbor, your spouse, or your children, I hope that you are a better person than you used to be. I mean, I hope that. And someone's nudging someone saying, yes, I certainly hope you. You know, I hope that you are getting some therapeutic realities from church. You found some community, and maybe you have some of your anxieties and fears met. I hope that's the case. It certainly is for me. And I hope that you believe in God. But the main reason we hope all of these things is because it's true. That's our claim. That's our proclamation. That's what we have been given to say to the world, that God is real. He has sent his Son into the world to atone for your sins. He has been raised and is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come again to judge the living and the dead. Repent and believe and receive the forgiveness of sins by being baptized into his name. You see, this is what we are doing. To however many surveys come out and what they say or don't say, the church is founded and grounded upon Jesus, the way, the truth, and the life. And that's what we'll continue to proclaim. We'll proclaim to the world who is, who he is, who we are, and what he has done to save in the midst of uncertain times or not. Well, I wanted to set the stage for that because that brings us to today's gospel and this overarching question of love. Because when we see sort of the landscape around us and the sort of the stakes that and how high the stakes are, well, then we continue to appreciate deeper and more fully what God has done in Christ for the world. So let's look at Jesus today, right? He's dealing with the Pharisees and the Sadducees. These are both religious leaders of the ancient Jews, and they had a great disagreement and were generally at odds with each other until they had a common enemy in Jesus. And so Jesus had just been dealing with the Sadducees, and then famously deals with the Pharisees time and time again because he kept getting at odds with the Pharisees because his followers were not following the law in what they considered to be the proper way. You remember the famous interaction where Jesus' disciples did not wash themselves ritually the proper way before eating dinner, which was considered by the Pharisees to be a sort of unpardonable sin. Jesus said to the Pharisees a famous statement, "It's not what goes into you that makes you unclean, but what comes out of your heart that makes you unclean. Because what comes out of your heart are evil, jealousy, licentiousness, envy, slander, murderous thoughts." And the list goes on, and this is your problem. Not that you do bad things, but that fundamentally you are a sinful, broken person. And of course, their answer to that was, well, who then can be saved? Indeed, no one, but for those who have been interceded for and given mercy by the blood of Christ on the cross for them. And so Jesus is interacting with these two groups. Now the Pharisees and the disciples the Pharisees and the Sadducees disagree about how to understand the Bible, the Old Testament at this point. The Sadducees believed that only the first five books of the Old Testament were authoritative. So they did not look to the prophets in any way as part of their sort of religious development. The Pharisees, on the other hand, loved the prophets, the law and the prophets, and so they were very much interested in sort of expanding the canon. So this is how we understand this interaction. When we see, it says, when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, well, because Jesus had just been arguing with the Sadducees, and Pharisees heard that he had silenced them, well, they ran over to him and said, "Hey, you know, maybe this guy's not so bad after all. Let's ask him about our favorite topic in the world, the law, and let's see what he says." Okay? So it says, when the Pharisees heard that he had silenced the Sadducees, they gathered together, and one of them, a lawyer, asked him to question to test him, "Teacher, which is the great commandment of the law?" And he said to him, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind. This is the first and great commandment, and the second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. On these two commandments depend all the law and the prophets." Well, you can see, as a Pharisee right then, you'd be all excited. You'd be like, "Yes, Jesus, you know, take that, Sadducees. You hear this guy? Like, we don't really understand him, but he's definitely not with you, because he just said the law and the prophets, and so maybe he's not so bad after all." And so this is the situation where we have Jesus and interacting with the Pharisees. But notice what Jesus does. He immediately, as he as often does the case, asks them a question. And not just any question. He doesn't ask them, "Why do you care so much?" or "What do you think about what I said?" He says, "Now, wait a minute. What do you think about the Messiah, the Christ, the Deliverer, the one that we have been waiting for forever? What do you think who he is? Who do you think about the Christ? Whose son is he?" And they said to him, "The son of David." He said to them, "How is it then that David in the Spirit calls him Lord, saying, 'If David calls him Lord, how is he his son?'" And they scratched their heads. No one was able to answer him, and they didn't ask him another question. They're like, I don't know what's going on here. We're just going to back away, right? Well, how are we supposed to understand this? Well, again, as I say, and I will continue to repeat, what Jesus was doing with his life was setting up a structure whereby only in light of his death and resurrection would his teaching become fully clear. That a lot of what he said before his death and resurrection was only fully appreciated when, by the power of the Holy Spirit, as he promised, he would bring enlightenment to his apostles, who would then go into the world preaching about something they previously were unaware of. This is how this works, that Jesus told his disciples that, don't worry, when I leave you, I will send you the Comforter who will guide you into all truth. Well, this is how we watch the New Testament actually play itself out. Former unbelievers are people who are confused, who said, you know, one imagines the disciples were like, what did he mean about this Son of David, Lord thing? Like, I don't know, don't ask him, he's in a bad mood sort of thing. You know, like, let's not bother Jesus with that question. Well, these are the same disciples that picked up on this very interaction and put it into their early preaching. Listen to the Apostle Peter on the day of Pentecost, the very first sermon that was preached on the day of Pentecost. He starts off with saying, brothers, I may say to you with confidence about the patriarch David that he both died and was buried and is in his tomb to this day. Being therefore a prophet and acknowledging that God had sworn an oath to him that he would let one of his descendants be on the throne, he foresaw and spoke about the resurrection of the Christ, that he was not abandoned to Hades, nor did his flesh see corruption. This Jesus God raised up, and of that all we are witnesses. Being therefore exalted at the right hand of God, and having received from the Father the promise of the Holy Spirit, he has poured out this, that you yourselves will be seeing and hearing. For David did not descend into the heavens, but he himself says, the Lord said to my Lord, sit at my right hand until I make your enemies your footstool. Let all those house of Israel, says Peter, therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified. You see how this is beginning to be put together. Is that Jesus' somewhat enigmatic sayings and his interactions with the people were in service of how he was going to then be seen as the crucified and exalted Lord on the account of his resurrection. And then Peter and his other apostles will go into the world proclaiming that this is what we now know. We were unaware and we didn't have a clear picture of who this man was until this Easter morning, and yet now we're going to walk into the world to proclaim to all the world exactly what he told us to do. Go into the world to make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, and teaching them all that I taught you. I mean, the Apostle Paul picks up on this in his preface to Romans, where he says that Christ is the fulfillment of the throne of David. We have the narrative, as it were, comes together in light of now what is clearly seen to be the case, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. You see, this is now what we understand what Jesus meant when he was sort of goading them about David and who was the Messiah. He knew what the answer was ultimately going to be, and yet wanted to continue to sort of interact with them because he knew that he would be raised and seated at the right hand of the Father and would reign, and his kingdom would be established on earth. But the nature of his kingdom would be entirely different, as he says, than all other kingdoms of this world, because it would come through the forgiveness of sins. Entrance into this kingdom would be on account of his death for sinners, and no other way. You see, the Pharisees and the Sadducees were not evil people. They were simply working with the information they had. And as sinful people, were blind to their own need and blind to the depth of their actual problem. You know, people don't know the depths of sin in their life until it has been revealed. People sort of think that they can fix themselves. People think they know what love is. You know these people. And they ask you, can't you tell that I'm loving you? Don't you see how much I love you? Like, I know what love is. It's something that you should do more of, like me. This is how people continue to try to wash the outside of the cup, while all along the inside is what really the problem is. Because what we think is love can only get to the surface of the problem, whereas Jesus' death reveals the true depth of our need and of our sin and opens our eyes to our need for forgiveness. You see, many of you, us, perhaps when we hear Jesus' summary of the law, are like the Pharisees. Think that's good news. You think that's the gospel, that the command to love is somehow what we're supposed to do. And to be sure, we are to love. But notice what Jesus was asked. The Pharisees didn't come to him and say, Jesus, what is the gospel? What is the good news? Jesus, what is the best thing the world could ever hear? Jesus, what is it you are going to die for and put into the mouth of your preachers? They said, no. What is the greatest commandment? What's the greatest law? And he just, without blinking, says, of course, it's love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself, which in our liturgy, you notice we immediately do what? Lord, have mercy. Christ, have mercy. Lord, have mercy. Because you see, for those who have come to see what love truly is, and they see that it was purchased on behalf of Christ, on behalf of us by Christ for the sake of sinners, and that radically reorients the entire relationship between us and God and us and our neighbor. Because when your relationship with anyone is predicated upon your right to be heard, what you have earned to stand before them, what they owe you with respect to your relationship, well, good luck having that be a fruitful, life-giving relationship. But when our relationship is grounded in the mercy of God, which then extends to other fellow sinners as those who, but for the grace of God, would know nothing of love, well, then that reorients the entire world and creates and, in fact, sustains what we now call the church. You see, the law is, as the apostle writes in Romans, holy, just, and good. But we are not. And the law brings us to our knees before Jesus, knowing, as the author of Hebrews writes, that we can appeal now to his throne, which is a throne of grace, the throne upon which he sits, and the one that he erected by his own death and resurrection for the world. You see, people will remain confused by what love is. People will remain confused about the sort of complexities and the power of this all-important idea, but not within the church. You see, people are confused about how to love, who to love, what to love, but not the church. Because we, in fact, know what love is, or more accurately, we know who love is and how he has shown us that love. And we won't rest. We will continue to proclaim, no matter what surveys come out. We will continue to preach, teach, sing, and live in that love until he comes again. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Amen.
Standing, let us confess our faith in the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth.
Of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, eternally God, from the Father, and was God of God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father, through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven, was incarnate from the Virgin Spirit, from the Virgin Mary, and was ordained man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered, died, and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven, and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom on heaven and on earth.
Prayers of the people. Let us pray for the church and for the whole world, saying, hear our prayer. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being and unity of the people of God, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For Foley Beach, our Archbishop, Mark Lawrence, our Bishop, Ted, J.D., Joyce, our clergy, for all clergy and people of this diocese and congregation, Lord, in your mercy. For all those who proclaim the gospel at home and abroad, and for all who teach and disciple others, Lord, in your mercy. For our brothers and sisters in Christ who are persecuted for their faith, Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For our nation, for those in authority, and all in public service, especially Donald Trump, our president, members of Congress, justices of the Supreme Court, and all state and local authorities. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
For all those who are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity, especially the Alteen family, John Ault, Idlett family, Bernie and Linda Baker, Pat Berry, Scott Berry, Elaine Baddock, Rochelle Baddock, Josh Bellachico, Sterling Bowling, Lionel Cantrell, Scott Coker, Crowley family, Dan and Betty Ann Davis, Roger Donnelly, Duval family, Elvis family, Al Fisher, Andrew Fermanchek, Chris Goodson, Richard Gray, Marcel Hart, Jamie Hemingway, Doug and Jeannie Henderson, Brooks Jenkins, Wayne Lackey, Horsey Lindsay, Bill and Louise Miller, Dane and Peggy Naismith, Gary and Ellen Pruitt, the Quinn family, Rita Shaw, Ken Schnupp, Pam Stroud, Gary White, Caroline Williams, Nancy Wilms, those with job loss or reduction in pay, expectant mothers Sarah Bellachico Zimbardi, homebound Fran Cheatham, Pat McCullough, Sarah Miller, Louise Perry, Becky Tootin, Grace Young, for our deployed military, Ryan Boyer, Michael Dean, Mary Emily Slott, for Bishop Campicha and Diocese of Marsabit, our Haitian partners, the Church of the Holy Spirit, men and women in uniform, those we named this morning. Lord, in your mercy, for all those who have departed this life in the certain hope of the resurrection and thanksgiving, let us pray. Lord, in your mercy, your Heavenly Father, thank you that you have promised to bind up the wounds of the brokenhearted, among them women whose lives have been impacted by the incarceration of a loved one. Thank you for inspiring the establishment of Kairos Outside, which ministers nationwide to women who trod the long, sorrowful road of doing time with their loved ones who are behind bars. Thank you especially for working through many Christchurch members who found and support Kairos Outside Lowcountry, which will hold its weekend number 2 retreat in May of 2021. Please bless all the team members as they prepare over the coming months. Above all, may your Holy Spirit work through the team members to share with the guests the forgiveness and transforming love of our Lord Jesus Christ. O Almighty, most merciful God, in this time of the coronavirus and all other perils of this world, we flee to you with strength and protection. Deliver us, we beseech you, from peril. Give us skill and success to all those by prospering the means of men be fair and good. Grant that perceive you in our prayers, we may apply our hearts to the heavenly wisdom which feels you for our life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Heavenly Father, grant these our prayers for the sake of Jesus Christ, our only mediator and advocate, who lives and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Let us humbly confess our sins to Almighty God. Most merciful. has promised forgiveness of sins to all those who sincerely repent and with true faith turn to Him. Have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the word of God to all who truly turn to Him. Come to me, all who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Peace be to you, John. Peace be to you. Please be seated. Welcome, Christ Church kids. So cute. Oh, and splat. But back up. Good. Our annual commitment Sunday, where we make an offering of our pledges for our financial gifts to the life and ministry of Christ Church and its mission, will be on Sunday, November 1st. That's All Saints Sunday. That's next Sunday. So if you haven't already turned in your pledge card, I hope that you will do so then. If you don't, we'll give you a call and remind you, but surely we can do that without a call and a reminder. It's important, and it's a blessing to give for the Lord's work and in His community. We thank you for continuing to register for services each Sunday. Our youth discipleship is kicking off the high school today at 4:30. High school students at 4:30 today in the parish hall. And now each Sunday, middle and high school students have a discipleship class with Alonzo Crawford, our new youth minister, at 10:10 in the parish hall. So pass the word and come and be a part of this revived ministry. The next opportunity for baptism is Saturday, October 31st. So go ahead and let us know now if you know if someone needs to be baptized so that we can include you in our preparation for that Saturday morning baptism service. Also on that Saturday morning, October 31st, we're going to live stream the Diocesan Men's Summit with Bishop Lawrence as the speaker. All the churches will be doing this, or most of them at least. We'll be doing it in our parish hall, starting with breakfast and then the summit, and then we'll have finish our day with lunch at the men's shed. So a great time, men, to be together, be built up, and to bring a friend. The blood drive next will be on November 9th in the afternoon, 2 to 6 p.m. in the parish hall. Please register for that so that we know that you're coming. If you're able to give blood, I encourage you to do so. The annual parish meeting will be on Sunday, November 15th. We will not have an 8 o'clock service on that Sunday. We'll have a 9 o'clock service and an 11 o'clock service. And between the two, here in the church, we'll have our annual parish meeting. Oh, it's not that bad. Yours, O Lord, is the greatness and the power and the glory and the victory and the majesty. For everything in heaven and on earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. All things come from you, O Lord, and of your own have we given you. Thank you.
your communion wafer from your plastic bag.
That's why.
The Lord be with you.
And with your
spirit. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right, our duty and our joy, always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. For you are the source of light and life. You made us in your image and called us to new life in Jesus Christ our Lord. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. In love, you made us for yourself, and when we had sinned against you and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent your only Son, Jesus Christ, into the world for our salvation. By the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, he became flesh and dwelt among us. In obedience to your will, he stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself once for all, that by his suffering and death we might be saved. By his resurrection, he broke the bonds of death, trampling hell and Satan under his feet. As our great high priest, he ascended to your right hand in glory, that we might come with confidence before the throne of grace. For in the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. When he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Likewise, after supper, Jesus took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. For this is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many, for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this in remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, and we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your word and Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ. Sanctify us also that we may worthily receive this holy sacrament and be made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. In the fullness of time, put all things in subjection under your Christ and bring us with all your saints into the joy of your heavenly kingdom, where we shall see our Lord face to face. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him and with him and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Alleluia! Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
And we do not presume to come to this your table, O merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your abundant and great mercies. We are not worthy so much as to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord whose character is always to have mercy. Grant us therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Amen. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with thanksgiving. Let us now receive the gifts of God for the people of God, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
The body of Christ, the bread of heaven.
And on behalf of the church, the blood of Christ, the cup of salvation. Amen. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for feeding us with the spiritual food of the most precious body and blood of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and for assuring us in these holy mysteries that we are living members of the body of your Son and heirs of your eternal kingdom. And now, Father, send us out to do the work you have given us to do, to love and serve you as faithful witnesses of Christ our Lord, to him, to you, and to the Holy Spirit, be honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our risen Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
In the name of Christ.